Warning, this video will contain opinions. This is the most important thing here. This is what I think, and in the end, what anyone thinks doesn't matter. Not you, not me, not anyone. What matters is facts, and when it comes to these things, there are no absolutes. Remember that while you're crucifying me.
Hello, it's the Janos. So, a while ago, during a live stream with D-Man 1954, I made the statement that I preferred Godzilla 1998 to Godzilla 2014. Put down the pitchforks, please. I've since thought a lot about that, and today I've decided to analyze both movies and see if I can justify that statement. I'm confident I can, but I'm open to alternative results. I'm not especially fond of either film. Not so much as Godzilla films, but fundamentally as films. This makes this difficult, as I will have to watch both of these two-hour films several times to be able to pull this off. Endurance round, start! Okay, let's do this.
I'm going to be lumping actor performances in this section, so 2014 fanboys might just want to skip this section. Both movies have horrid acting, but I do actually have a case for 1998 here. In 1998, the acting was hokey, cheesy, and over the top. I dare say it's so bad it's funny. In 2014, for the most part, the acting is wooden and dull. A lot of people give Cranston and Watanabe props for being the best in the film, and while I agree that they are in fact the best, they're far from perfect. Cranston is over the top in a very endearing way, but is killed off way too early. Watanabe, hashtag not my Sarazawa, who is more prominent in the film, comes off as the generic wisdom giver of the movie. Every one of his lines seems kind of pretentious, especially the ham-fisted Hiroshima sob story. His "let them fight" line is about as much of a meme as "that's a lot of fish." Actually, let's make an example of those two lines. Matthew Broderick actually has a sarcastic inflection on his line read, as if to say, "yes, that was cheesy. What did you expect?" And that fits the tone they were going for. Watanabe's line read, on the other hand, was kinda lazy. The only emotion on his face is that scowl he has the whole time. He looks bored, like he'd rather be anywhere else. And that gravelly whisper he does, what's even up with that? Every single one of his lines is in that voice. Maybe he wanted to sound older? He played an older character in Letters to Iwo Jima, but he didn't do that voice. I don't think Watanabe did too much better than the rest of the cast. Now, let's talk character motivation. Nick, from 1998, is a scientist hired for the job. He had a girlfriend once. His girlfriend is a determined reporter. Her friends are... insufferable. I can't even pretend that they're worth anything. I hate them. Also, Leon the Professional is there.
So I got that going, which is nice.
There's also Kent Brockman from The Simpsons being a jerk to everyone. A Siskel and Ebert joke that is hilarious due to pure irony. Also, army dudes. They don't have much else interesting, they're just army dudes. Everyone else is just a setup and punchline in human form. 2014 has a soldier haunted by tragedy who wants to protect his family. His father has driven himself mad searching for the truth. The soldier's wife is a nurse. Watanabe is an old foreign guy that frowns a lot and imparts wisdom and exposition. His assistant is just kind of there to agree with everything he says. Then there's army dudes. Lots of army dudes. Nothing else, just army dudes. Most of them die anyways, so why bother developing them? Right, Edwards? Let's be honest, both movies have pretty cliched and troped characters. This isn't really the strong point of either movie. I give the point to 1998 simply because of the so bad it's funny quality and its general quotability. Godzilla 1998 isn't very complicated. Monster destroys boats, then goes to New York for some reason to lay eggs and break more stuff. Scientists work with the army to try and stop it. They kept the plot simple and pander to idiots. This is a Hollywood blockbuster after all. The only complicated bits are character drama, but it's just more cliched trash anyway, so who cares? 2014 is complicated. A thing happens that kills the main character's mom. Years later, he's a soldier with a family that he wants to protect. His dad gets arrested for trespassing Japan, so the guy, I'll start calling him Ford now, goes over there to bail him out, and gets roped into his espionage shenanigans, and you get the picture. There are many attempts at twists and turns, but everything happens just to get Ford up close and personal with the monsters. Both movies are kind of all over the place in terms of locations, but at least 2014's locations made a little bit of sense. 2014 tried to be smart and serious to pander to the 1954 purists, but also had giant monsters fighting to pander to the rest of Godzilla fans. I don't think that angle worked out quite as well as they thought it did. I think it would have been better if they weren't so serious. Let's be honest, kaiju fights are impossible to take seriously. 2014 tried to be both the anti-nuclear and force of nature allegories, and those both fall flat. If you take like the 4 or 5 lines about how bad nukes are and how nature is better than humans, you'd never even know that's what they were going for. 1998 didn't even bother with it. They had no subtext at all. It was just an action movie that doesn't try to be anything more than it was. Trying to have underlying themes is a hard thing to do right. It's the kind of thing where if you try and fail, it can end up ruining everything. Gojira and Shin Gojira are metaphors for past tragedies, but they don't actually mention those tragedies one time. That's right, they had this thing called subtlety. Subtlety is the most important thing to consider when creating a metaphor. If you have people constantly talking about how nukes are bad and how nature points out the folly of man, you lose all subtlety. You should never have to explain yourself if you do things right. On the merit of not trying to be more than it is, I give the point to 98. Sometimes less is more. Even Emmerich gets that to some extent. Edwards doesn't understand what that means, as you'll see in the next section. You all knew this was coming. It had to be done. Deal with it, crybabies. I'll start by praising 2014's effects and sound design. It's leagues better than 1998. But the action scenes in 2014 are infamously loud. There's a few, oh my god, that's so cool moments in there, but it's pretty tame the rest of the time. There's only about 10 minutes of Godzilla in this movie, most of which is him swimming, and it's a 2-hour movie. That's only about a 12th of the movie. And to counter the Godzilla has just as much screen time as he always gets argument, I want to present you with the fact that the only movie with a substantial amount less is Monster Zero. And that's a much shorter film with a lot of cool sci-fi stuff going on in between. And since the aforementioned characters are so bland and wooden, 2014 comes off as dull. As far as design goes, 2014 is a lot better. Okay, I forgot to mention that they did the dickest move ever and intentionally designed the Winged Muto to make people think that Rodan or Mothra was in the movie. Not cool, guys. A lot of people say that 98's design is okay if you don't call it Godzilla, but I don't think it's that appealing either way. Spiky T-Rex iguana just doesn't do it for me, I'm sorry. So the debate here is quality versus quantity. But what is the quality of the monster action in 1998? Well, this may be my boldest statement yet, but I say that the 1998 movie has better action. Let me explain before you have me fired from Wikizilla. 98 has a great many action scenes. After the initial incident, the film moves along at a good pace. In 2014, most of the monster action is fleeting glimpses. As a matter of fact, Gareth Edwards actually brags about the Honolulu scene. You know the one, where Godzilla shows up and roars and you think there's going to be a fight. but it cuts away and you see a little bit of it on TV in the background. That was the director's favorite scene, and it shows because every monster scene after that seems to be trying to do the same thing. Remember Edward's first movie, Monsters? Of course you don't. It sucked. It's pretentious and teases you with kaiju. Now, doesn't that sound familiar? Emmerich is an action director, and he knows how to appeal to the majority. All of his films are financial successes, despite their critical panning. Why? Because there is a massive disconnect between critics and casual moviegoers. People like it when the title monster gets a ton of screen time, and 1998 shows him off almost gratuitously. In the case of both movies, they drag like a sack of bricks when the monsters are not on screen. There's just less dragging in 1998. I'm sorry, but 98 gets the point here too. So, I've just gone on record and said that I prefer 1998 over 2014 in every way, right? Wrong. 2014 has higher production values and way better sound and music. Those things may seem small to you, but to me, I'd say that makes the score pretty close. But 98 still squeaks by. I challenge you to watch both movies back to back twice like I did before you comment about how wrong I am. What you find may surprise you. To quote Richard Dawkins, keep an open mind, but not so open that our brains fall out. So, that's all I have for now. Hope you found it informative instead of offensive. Oh, that mob looks most angry. To finish, I'm going to tag D-Man 1954 in this because I want to see a rebuttal from someone who didn't ruin their image on their first real video. Oh, they're here. Gotta go.